Hello and welcome to UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College and your host. Monumental in scope and vividly detailed, the subject of this edition of UDC Forum, Chocolate City, A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital, tells the tumultuous four-century story of race and democracy in Washington, D.C. My guests for the next 60 minutes are the authors of this new work. Chris Myers Ash is editor of Washington History Magazine and teaches history at Colby College. George Derek Musgrove is an associate professor of history at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
It's great to be here. It's great to be back home on
campus.
Yes,
when we want to let our audience know that the two of you have been faculty here at UDC.
That's right.
In fact, we shared an office.
We did.
Together.
We did.
As the historians on campus. And Chris, you have your own history here.
Absolutely. And this book that we wrote was born here.
It was.
When Derek and I were both on campus. This is where we first conceived the idea and talked ourselves into doing it.
I remember the semester when you were teaching that history course and DC history. And
yeah.
It was new. And so tell us how that connected, the two of you got together and produced this wonderful publication.
Sure, sure. So, you know, I had the good fortune to get assigned the DC history class here on campus. And I didn't really know what I was doing. I mean, I devoured all the DC history I could find. When it came down to it, I was looking for a book that I could assign to my students that would, you know, really tell nice stories that would draw them in, that would help them to understand the city in specific places. And there wasn't one out there that was at least very current. And so when Chris got to campus not too long after I taught that class, I said, Chris, man, wouldn't it be great if there was a book like this? And, you know, Chris said, yeah, they really would. And I sort of echoed, yeah, it really would. Chris went off and wrote a book proposal. And sent it to me a couple days later and said, hey man, edit this thing and would you like to join me in writing this book that we talked about? And I thought, man, I was just talking idly. And 6 years later, you know, here we are with the book that we dreamed of.
I thought he was serious the whole time. So I said, yeah, we should, absolutely. You know, for me, it's really personal. I grew up here. I grew up in D.C. I love D.C. and, you know, I love the city. I feel like the city doesn't get the respect that it deserves from the country that it serves. You know, I live in Maine now, and you talk to people in places like Maine or other places around the country about D.C. They don't know anything about the capital. They don't know anything about the history. And you know, when I was a ninth grader at Deal Junior High School just up the road, I took a D.C. history class. It was required for ninth graders at the time, and we were supposed to spend half a year doing that class, and then the second half of the year we were going to do world history. And the teacher walks in the first day and says, well, we're not going to spend half a year on DC history. We're going to spend 6 weeks because DC doesn't really have much history. And that's what she's telling DC public school students about their own city. And that kind of disrespect does not go unanswered. It may take 30 years, but you know, I'm not going to forget that kind of disrespect. And this book is a long delayed, but and a very long response to that comment, and more broadly to this idea that DC doesn't have a history or DC, you know, no one's really from DC, and all this stuff that you hear from people who aren't from here. And we say, no, you're wrong. DC has a great history. It's a fascinating history. It's a maddening history, but it's a real rich history.
I'm married to a native Washingtonian, so I know that there's history here, and I know that there are neighborhoods, but it's wonderful to know that you have now made it possible for others to know that, because you're right. People see the government, or they see the tourist town, and that's all they see. Mm-hmm. And it's quite interesting because we have a whole new set of people coming into the city now. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And many of them want to know the history. Mm-hmm. Many of them want to know about the neighborhoods that they live in. So not only does this provide them that history, but also those individuals, and we all have had students, when you've said to them to do a historical paper on their neighborhoods or their quadrant, and they say, well, nothing happened. and there's nothing there to write about. So this is going to address that. But when you were doing this, what did you learn as a native Washingtonian and as someone who's been here for a while, but not native?
Wow, so much. I mean, there was a lot that that we both learned all along the way. I mean, about whether it's different people and different movements that they led. I know for me, I mean, Derek's heard this, you know, a dozen times. You know, I love the story of the Emergency Committee on the Transportation Crisis, which was the civic group that grew out in the mid to late 1960s, and it grows out of opposition to this plan to build freeways, to basically pave over much of downtown Washington and the neighborhoods surrounding it. And, you know, I really didn't know. You know, I didn't know why when you come through on Highway 395 and you go onto the Capitol and you're speeding along and suddenly, wham, there you are, back in the city, you're on New York Avenue. It's like, what happened to the freeway? Well, what happened to the freeway is the freeway proponents ran into the Emergency Committee on the Transportation Crisis with this little bald white guy with white hair and big glasses named Sammy Abbott, and this tall, thin black guy with a dashiki and an afro and black sunglasses. And the two of them led this movement, this interracial, cross-class, citywide, city and suburb movement to say, no, you can't ram freeways down our throat. We may not have the vote, we may not have power in this democracy, but we're going to organize our own power, our own people power, and we are going to stop this, even though Congress is in support of the freeways, even though the press was in support of the freeways, all the businesses wanted the freeways, it was inevitable that they were going to build freeways and turn our city into something like, you know, Little Rock or Atlanta with freeways everywhere. Even though all those powerful interests were aligned behind the freeways, the people said no. And they won.
What is your favorite story, Derek?
Chris says there's so many, and there really are so many. I mean, you know, we would start to get a lot of these stories from our students, actually. I know I had an assignment where they would do a history of their block, and the things I would find out were just remarkable. But the blocks that really interested me and the ones that really captured me as we were doing the story were the ones around Columbia Heights. You know, I had come to D.C. initially to work as a member of the Freedom School program. It was sponsored by a group called Sojourners, sort of a left-wing Catholic organization. They hosted this Freedom School right up on Girard between 13th and 14th. And so I lived in that area and got to know a little bit of the history while I was there in the Freedom School. And what I found through the book and what really helped me to contextualize, you know, my experience back in 1995 and 96 with Sojourners, was that Sojourners and many other organizations like the Community for Creative Nonviolence were all of these white new left organizations that were moving into Columbia Heights following a number of African American black power organizations that were moving into Columbia Heights, like the Drum and Spear Bookstore, like the Center for Black Education, like SNCC, like SCLC, like Pride, all these groups that had already made their home in that area. And it was this interracial hotbed of new left and black power activism. And if you head down the hill just a little bit more, you know, feminist activism in this, you know, just this little tiny area where you could see the entire universe of the new left. And to imagine that and to know that this place where I had sort of come to really love the city and the people that lived here was just a center of new left activism in a very radical city was just one of those wonderful revelations that we had as we moved through the sources.
When you talked about the feminist aspect of it, and there are so many of those organizations and so many of those leaders that were very active during that time, and some still are, do you, in your book, when you look at the leadership and how that feminist movement translated into women in power, and I'm thinking of the first female mayor, Sharon Pratt, later Sharon Pratt Kelly, and now we've got the second female mayor. Mm-hmm. So you see Washington being one of those places where there's that political movement that's empowering people that were not normally empowered.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. My favorite story, you know, Chris's favorite story is ECTC. My favorite story is from the book is about a woman named Louise Thomas who is poor. She lives on W Street, 1400 block of W Street. And her history is really one of displacement via gentrification. She was brought to the city by her parents. Her father shoveled coal at a power plant, and they lived in this ramshackle apartment in Georgetown. And the city, as it was trying to clean up slum properties in the 1950s, condemned their apartment. The owner fixed it up, sold it to a white couple, and that was sort of part of the gentrification of Georgetown that really wiped out the black community in that area. She ends up in Columbia Heights, and around 2000, she's living in another apartment where the landlord really just treats it horribly. There's reams and reams of housing code violations that the folks in the apartment complain about, but the landlord just does nothing. They keep complaining to the city, and the city does nothing. And then finally, Mayor Anthony Williams, through a program called Hot Properties, cracks down on the landlord and actually sends housing inspectors out to look at what these folks are complaining about. And they find dozens upon dozens of housing code violations. In fact, they're so bad that the city says, we've got to close this place down. Everyone has to get out, you're evicted. And Louise Thomas said, my God, this is not happening to me again. This will not happen to me twice in my life. So she and her neighbors refused to leave and sued the city for discrimination. And their argument was, you're trying to crack down on landlords who are breaking the law, but you're displacing all of the renters who are asking you to enforce the law. And they forced the city to then sue the landlord to actually get him to fix up the place. The city gets a settlement where they sell the residents the building for $1, ban the landlord from owning any property in the city ever again. And she becomes a homeowner. And for me, that is just one of those instances where that deep democracy that those new left and those black power and those feminist activists are seeking in the 1960s and 1970s really bears fruit in later decades. And you see people who are not seen as elite, regular leaders, the people that you would think would be running things, are in fact able to seize a little piece of the city for themselves.
Mm-hmm. Now, Chocolate City, where did the name come from? Because we know it's not chocolate anymore.
Yes, uh-huh. Yes.
Not presently chocolate.
Yes. Chris, would you?
Yeah. Well, it's cool and it's catchy, right? And it's Parliament.
It's P-Funk. Mm-hmm. It's P-Funk. For folks who have parents who grew up in the 60s and whose father is a huge Parliament Funkadelic fan, this was an obvious choice. Of course, Parliament Funkadelic's 1975 album, Chocolate City, really takes a name that the DC residents had been using for the city for a couple of years at that point and makes it national, right? And lays DC out as the preeminent chocolate city. There's that wonderful line from the song which says, we got Newark, we got Gary, somebody told me we got LA, but you're the capital CC. And so there's a way in which all these other places are, demographic majority, black majority cities as well. But DC is not just a very black city. By the time this song comes out, it's 70%+ black, but it's the capital of these United States of America. And symbolically, that's terribly important. And DC sort of holds that moniker from the late 1960s to the late 1990s. Until the control board takes home rule away for a short period of time. And then very soon after that, African-Americans lose the demographic majority. But that moment in time really comes to define a great deal of how people know the city. And then there's just a larger argument we're making.
Yeah, and our history is not just the history of the 1960s to the present. And we go all the way back to the 1600s, where the first encounters between Native Americans and the European explorers who first came here. And so we don't want people to think, oh, this is just during the heyday of the Chocolate City period. But what we're arguing in this book, and the reason why we do use this as a title, is that DC has always been a chocolate city, in the sense that the presence of a large black population from the city's inception as the nation's capital is the single most important dynamic in the city's history. To understand DC, you have to understand, yes, it's the seat of government. That's why it's here. That's its raison d'etre. Okay. But if you really want to understand the life and the people and how they've interacted and where they've lived and the changes that have enveloped the city and how it's transformed from a plantation society into this cosmopolitan metropolis, you have to understand race. Race is the central fault line of DC life. and the central dynamic that runs through DC history. And so the racial tensions, the changing racial dynamics, the power of race, these are important things to understand. And so that's why Chocolate City is a to us, it's a great title to encompass the whole of DC history. And it's funny, for me, when we first started talking about this, this idea, this project, we're going to write this book, Chocolate City, it's going to be great. And, this one family member, I said, we're going to write Chocolate City. And she's like, she got this big look, wide eyes, frightened look on her face. And she takes me aside and she says, are we allowed to say that? Right? Are white people, can you say that? Right? And because there's this idea that, Chocolate City, that's a bad thing, right? That's an insult. It's so black, right? As if that's automatically an insult. And you try to explain, it's like, no, this is a term of endearment. This is a term of pride. This is a term of people asserting their voice and asserting their place and their claim to the city. And that this is our city. A history of race is the history of all of us. White people, black people, Latinos, African immigrants who come in, Asian immigrants. This is the city of all of us, because it's a history of all of us, because it's the history of race in the city. And we all have a race.
It's quite interesting when you talk about the city changing, and when the Emancipated Compensation Act was signed, mm-hmm. you again have DC, or maybe for the very first time, having that national recognition for its African American population being the first free. And mm-hmm. then you add Howard University, and you have the Mecca, and you mm-hmm. have all of these things, churches and businesses, sure. and African Americans mm-hmm. Being able to have some ability to navigate and some agency mm-hmm. that they don't have in other parts of the city. You see these neighborhoods being Absolutely. Established, these old families being mm-hmm. established. So talk about the tension now, where you see the no longer the ability to have some of those conclaves as chocolate mm-hmm. Or have that much agency as before with what's happening with the gentrification sure. and the housing explosion in terms of the expense of being unable to stay in certain neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm. Well, so the first thing I think we should lay out is that the African-American population is still a plurality within the city. You still have a black population in the city that is 300,000 plus strong. And that's important to remember, because because we're making the argument that DC has always been a chocolate city, mm-hmm. With or without the demographic majority, we don't want to ignore the fact, just because the population has been reduced quite significantly, that very large number of people that are still here aren't somehow as significant. That's a large number of people, and they're still very powerful, right? The mayor is still African American. There's still a very large contingent of African Americans on the city council. And by the way, I think the city council is as liberal as it is, partially because it's in a place that was not too long ago, mm-hmm. Chocolate City. But that aside, I do think, you're pointing to something that's terribly important within the lives of a lot of DC residents today, which is that the feeling of loss and the feeling mm-hmm. of change is all about us, because the city is changing quite dramatically. 10, 15 years ago, you had a pretty large black majority as compared to the plurality that you have today. I think Chris likes to point out, and this is absolutely apt, is that the city has actually changed much faster than this in the past. And so one of the things that the book helps us to do is gives us an understanding that, the changes that we're going through, as dramatic as they appear, are actually, in certain cases, mm-hmm. less jarring than those occur that, say, during the Civil War, where roughly 33,000 African Americans were added to an African American population that had topped out in the low teens, right? Mm-hmm. So you're talking about, double the population coming in and joining those folks. Mm-hmm. In between the 1950s and the 1970s, you have a tremendous change in the African American population.
And in the white population, it's interesting. We opened the book in the very first chapter with the word Anacostia, mm-hmm. which in modern Washington history is synonymous with black, right? Certainly, when I was growing up, you say the word Anacostia, and that's what people thought. And so, come to find out, actually, not that long ago, Anacostia was a white community, a working class white community, Congress Heights. it's a white community. It was the center of the DC hillbilly music scene, of all things, back in the 50s and 60s. And you know, these are things people don't realize, that 1950, Anacostia was 83% white. And then by 1970, it's 85% black. You know, so the pace of change, although dramatic now, and we see it and we're experiencing it, so we feel it much more readily, but yes, there have been other times in our history when racial demographics have changed more rapidly even than today.
Well, what you're saying, it seems that there was the shift was from one extreme to, not extreme, but from one plurality to another. There wasn't that period where it was integrated for a period of time. It just seemed to switch over.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's interesting now because, I mean, part of what we want to do is contextualize all this stuff, right? That's what historians do. Yeah. I mean, we're not very good at predicting the future. You know, people are always asking, well, what's DC going to look like 20 years from now? And you know, we're not good at that, but we are good at contextualizing what's going on and say, you know, gentrification is not just a 21st century phenomenon, right? I mean, you could go back to the Nakustan, the Native Americans who were here, and if you want to talk about displacement, that's where we start, right? We talk about displacement in the 1600s, but also more recently in the last century, there have been four different waves of gentrification that have washed over different parts of the city. You know, with Georgetown in the 20s and 30s, you know, Georgetown was a working class community with a very vibrant black, you know, low and working class black community there that was revitalized and basically disappeared in the course of the early 20th century. Foggy Bottom, Logan Circle, some of these other places were gentrified before the current wave, before the 21st century. And so we want to contextualize that so people can see how the city has responded, how people have responded to that. And I bring up the example of the Emergency Committee on Transportation Crisis again to say, what seems like it might be inevitable at one point in time, like right now, gentrification seems inevitable. It's inevitable that the poor are going to be priced out and that the city's going to be all condos. You know, certain things seem inevitable because the press likes it and the powers that be like it and the businesses like it. They liked highways too, right? And so what seems inevitable can become impossible and even unthinkable if people object.
One of the things that Washington has always been unique in is that it serves as the nation capital, of course, but it also serves as home to a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And when people come, tourists, coming from a tourist town, I know you come from one thing, you don't want to see neighborhoods, you're not interested in finding out about schools and all of that. But when you have a city like Washington, with the history that it has, and you're in the 21st century now, and you see the cranes in the sky, and I know things aren't always inevitable, but you have such a widening gap between the haves and the have-nots, and between who can stay and who can't stay, and who are actually coming in, and who are actually having to go. How, and I know as historians, we're not predicting the future, but what is happening now with Washington? How is it viewed by the native Washingtonians and by those who are coming in and those who are just barely hanging on? Seems like you've got three different views through three different lenses.
Absolutely.
Yeah. No, you absolutely do. I think for a lot of native Washingtonians, particularly African-American native Washingtonians, the city that they knew and the city that they liked is slipping away. And that's not to say that, you know, the Chocolate City years were all wonderful years. Of course, some of those years were the years that DC was the murder capital. Some of those years were the years that DC had a thriving crack trade that claimed hundreds of lives, right? But there was this feeling that the city was theirs, you know, and that I think is slipping away as African Americans lose the demographic majority. Oddly enough, and we point this out in the epilogue, for a lot of new residents, the feeling of the city is that it's a hip place to go, right? There's good jobs there. There's a lot of young people. There's a great gym scene, and that's all true. I mean, there's money.
I mean, high-paying jobs.
If you look at a lot of the young people, because the major in-migration of the early 21st century is millennials, right? Young professionals, people who would have gone straight to the suburbs. But because the city is very attractive and they don't like the car culture of the suburbs, and traffic really is horrible around here, they end up coming in much greater numbers to the city. And they've created a pretty attractive scene for themselves and for their cohort. And so I think that they see the city in a very different way. I don't think that, mm-hmm. 20 years ago, Forbes magazine would have placed this as one of the coolest cities in the right. country. I don't know how much, Ford's notion of hipness is what it's worth. But nonetheless, there's a way in which the city is seen very differently by that group of people who mm-hmm. are coming in and creating space for themselves, which they have every right to do. Mm-hmm.
It'll be interesting to see what happens in the next 5 or 10 years as these millennials age. They have families, some of them may put down roots and stay here for the long haul, but many of them won't. Whether they decamp for the suburbs, as mm-hmm. previous generations of well-off families have done, or whether they go back to wherever they're from originally, it's hard to tell. And I think that's part of what's behind a lot of the frustration and even the bitterness among longtime residents mm-hmm. is to say, you come here, you change our city, but you're not of this city, yeah. right? You're not investing yourself in the city and the neighborhoods and these places. You just want to change them, yeah. right?
And without respecting them. We'll pick that up right after this break. UDC Forum will continue right after this break.
I would call UDC my saving grace. One thing that makes UDC so unique is that it encompasses all the definitions of what diversity means, not just in terms of racial diversity, but in terms of socioeconomic background.
But here at UDC, this is not your typical HBCU. We have a lot of different populations and international students and students such as me who are single parents. So I've met several different backgrounds, diverse people, religions, different majors, different age groups, tax brackets that all come here cumulatively to all achieve the same thing, and that's success.
Being at an HBCU has been a great experience for me. It's a really remarkable thing to see such diversity. It makes such a difference to me personally to be in an environment with such a broad range of students from all over the world.
So far, I've realized that UDC has a strong sense of community, and everything we do here, I feel like we're doing it as a team, and it's just a really nurturing environment, and it's just helping me focus in and realize what I want to do in my life.
I do enjoy the interpersonal relationships that you get to build amongst your peers, the faculty and the staff.
I enjoy being in a classroom with fewer students because I feel like the professor pays attention to me.
I know all my teachers personally, which has given me a lot of opportunities. I might even be working with one of my professors on research papers, which means I can be published in my second year of college, which is huge.
You get to do your own research. You work one-on-one with your professor, publishing scientific papers with just you and your professor together. You are actually learning techniques and skills that can prepare you for the rest of your life.
I feel like with the quality of education I am receiving here, I can become who I've always wanted to be.
Welcome back. I'm talking with Derek Musgrove and Chris Myers Ash about their new book, Chocolate City, A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital. We were talking about the response from Native Washingtonians mm-hmm. to new individuals coming into their city.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Chris points out that there's this feeling on the part of a lot of Native Washingtonians that there's not a deep investment in the city on the part of new residents. And whether or not that be true, because I think there's evidence coming out now that is in fact the case. A lot of people that came here that changed the demographics of the city, but also in a major way changed the socioeconomics of the mm-hmm. city, right? Just made it a more expensive place to be because of housing demand, are now starting to head back home as the jobs that they were really flocking to when the rest of the country was in recession those jobs are now opening back up so they can take off and head back home. I think the other reason you see a lot of alarm and even a little bit of resentment is because of the tremendous wealth inequality between new residents and longtime residents. The wealth gap between white residents in the last couple of years and black residents is 81-1. It's absolutely stunning. Astronomical. And what that means then is that many of the white residents who are heading into the city just have a tremendous leg up in their competition with current residents for housing, for apartments. They can just outbid them. And that, I think, in the end, is really one of the major issues. Because if you look at all the new housing that's being created for these populations that are heading into the city, it is by and large being carved out of the existing housing stock. You can only go so high in DC. There's only so much land where you can go wide. And so what ends up happening is you go back and you refurbish old houses, or you go back and you gut old apartments, flip them into condos. And so the increase in high-cost apartments and high-cost rentals actually decreases the number of units available to low-income people. And that then, you know, causes a straightaway conflict over space and over access to the city.
When we look at the political arena and how that's changed over time, you know, we had the control board earlier, and we don't have that any longer. We certainly are doing much better. But there's another tension now about what it's going to look like. And is this the last African-American mayor we're going to have? Is this new population coming in looking at how they can actively take a larger political role? And then I won't talk about the bike lanes tension versus the churches and the parking. So there's some of these, the political one is certainly a major one, but then some of the other little things. Some are good to having all the restaurants, and there are plenty of residents in all neighborhoods that say, we always wanted to have more restaurants. We always wanted to have more of these things. But when the bagel is costing, you know, so much money, I mean, you can't afford to get the cup of coffee. So there's some major things that are just galling people.
And they're winners and losers, there's no question. And and a lot of times the winners are those who have the power, whether it's the economic power or cultural power to claim those winnings. And so yes, you can charge with $52 ribeyes and $13 cocktails, you're obviously appealing to a very small slice of the population. And it's interesting because politics has always been contentious in this city, right? And who gets to participate is a major animating force throughout the city's inception, particularly because we don't have a lot of power. So whatever power we do have, we fight over it because it's really important. We see this particularly after the Civil War, when black men are granted the right to vote in D.C. first, before anybody else. Years before the 15th Amendment is ratified in the Constitution, black men are voting and are participating in large numbers in the city. And it's interesting because you see the editorials in the Washington papers that are by white editors saying, white people, we've got to register. We've got to vote. You know, these black folks are really interested in voting. They want power. They're signing up. We've got to do it too. And so you have this really clamorous time where people are fighting over basic issues of democracy. And 1868, you get a white abolitionist mayor who wins with black votes, right? And you have this flourishing of interracial democracy for a time. But it's always fractious, right? It's always contentious. The flowering of citizen activism in the late 60s, early 1970s, that's a wonderful time. It's a hopeful time, but it's also a tumultuous time, right? You have lots of contentious meetings where people are grabbing each other's microphones, right, and jumping on tables, and it's contentious. And so when you're talking about issues of power and whose neighborhood is this and who belongs here and who doesn't, I mean, these are powerful issues that get people fired up. So it's going to be contentious. It's going to be fractious, and there are going to be some ugly scenes, and that's part of the clamor of democracy, is people are working these questions out on the ground.
And if I may, one of the things that we wanted this book to do is as people go into the very messy work of democracy, of trying to figure out how to live with each other, we wanted them to understand what they're stepping into. I mean, you know, places have a history, mm-hmm. right? And you mentioned bike lanes earlier, and you know, there's wonderful reporting that NPR did on the bike lanes, where, you know, they were interviewing people, and these people were saying, I just don't understand why people are reacting to bike lanes in this way. They're just bike lanes.
Just bike lanes, or yoga studios, or dog parks.
But what a lot of those people who were reacting to those bike lanes in a very negative way were saying is, I remember when there was, you know, very significant gentrification in the Shaw neighborhood, in Logan Circle, in the 70s, and it wasn't for me. And there were other people who were saying, I remember when there was significant gentrification in Foggy Bottom, in Georgetown, in Capitol Hill, and it wasn't for me. You know, bike lanes meant for them the beginning of a process of their displacement. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't know that history, you simply wouldn't understand why these people were reacting to something so innocuous that really is for everyone if they can access it in that way. Because for them, it meant a process. That process ended with them not being there. Mm-hmm. And they were trying to nip it in the bud.
Yeah, and that's part of what we want to do overall is to say it's complicated, right? Mm-hmm. And try to help people understand the complicated nature of the city's history, right? So that you don't see things just on, hey, it's just a bike lane kind of thing. You know, you'll be able to see much more deeply the tangled roots mm-hmm. of a lot of these problems. You know, I was reminded, I had this really interesting meeting. I was invited, when I was at UDC, I was invited to speak to a group of education reformers who were working in the city government. And they'd been, a lot of them had been attacked pretty viciously at many community meetings for closing schools. They didn't understand. You know, they thought of themselves as the good guys, right? We're coming in and we're closing these failing schools that are hurting your children, is how they perceive themselves. And they very quickly realized that the community did not see them as the good guys. Mm-hmm. And they couldn't figure it out. So I said, well, you know, will you come and teach us some history about the schools and race in the city and help us understand this? And I did, and you know, I kind of went around the room asking where everybody was from. Most of the reformers were white. Most of them were from mm-hmm. somewhere else. And I said to them, you know, 5 years from now, 3/4 of you aren't going to be around this table, right? Because you'll have gotten a great opportunity to go work in Oakland in the school system there or somewhere else. You know, you're going to find an opportunity and off you'll go, right? Just like you seized upon this opportunity in DC, and you'll be gone. And those folks in the community will still be there, right? And what they want you to understand is they were there before you got there, and they worked hard to build those schools that you call a failing school. And they know the woman who used to be principal of that school. And they understand the deep roots that school has in the community, and you don't. You come in here and you look at this spreadsheet and you see certain numbers and you're like, failing school, gotta close it. And you don't understand the history. And if you don't understand the history is going to slap you upside the head and say, pay attention to me, right? It's going to envelop you. And so we want to help people understand this history, to understand that when you step into this city, you don't step in as an individual without baggage. Like, we all carry baggage mm-hmm. into our conversations and our interactions with each other.
I want to talk a moment about the late Marion Barry. Because of him, there are so many well-to-do, established African-Americans that mm-hmm. are large middle class.
I got my first job from Marion Barry in the Summer Youth Employment Program.
When I was at mm-hmm. Howard doing my capstone project for senior year, I interviewed Marion mm-hmm. and Mary Treadwell mm-hmm. and Catfish Mayfield, okay? And that was my first encounter mm-hmm. with Marion, a charismatic mm-hmm. individual.
Very
but
much.
He changed the face of the way things were done here in terms of minorities being involved in these major contracts.
Mm-hmm. He did. Yeah. He very much did. If you know, when Marion Barry gets elected in 1978, and when he actually comes into office in 1979, the city is doing 7% of its business with minority firms. 7%. Now, mind you, 1979, this is a 70%+ black city. Mm-hmm. 1/10 of that of that actual population is reflected in the number of contracts that the city has with black firms. And Marion doesn't just come into office by himself, right? He comes into office as part of a group of reformers. One of the things that we looked into was how many people from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, Marion Barry, of course, being an alum himself, came to the city, and then how many went into his administration. The numbers are huge. Mm-hmm. A solid three dozen came to the city after 1965. And an easy half a dozen go into the upper reaches of his administration in 1979. One of them is Courtland Cox. Courtland Cox is put in charge of minority business contracting. And he goes to all the different agency heads around the government. He just says, look, if you want your job, I'm expecting that you're going to increase the number of minority businesses working with the city to 25% by the end of this administration. And being good bureaucrats, they exceeded that number, got it up to 35% by 1985. And as part of that process, the city creates a number of black millionaires. It even desegregates whole industries. When the city first floats its first bond, the lawyers who handle bonds up in New York with the big firms are all white. And Marion Barry walks in a room, as he did in most of these deals, and said, where are the black people? And so those bond firms wanted the city's business, and so they hired some black lawyers. And you have the first black bond lawyers in the country because the city floats its bond, because of the demand that the city do business with minority contractors. And that's a primary goal of that administration. And it works.
Mm-hmm. And Marion Barry is an extraordinary figure. He's the most talented politician in DC history. Also a polarizing figure. Mm-hmm. And we seek to paint him in all the complexity that he deserves. He's a remarkable civil rights leader. You know, he comes into town in 1965 to revitalize the SNCC chapter, and he's charismatic, he's smart, he's brash, he is bold, he is fearless, and he scares the establishment, white and black, right? They don't mm-hmm. know what to do with this guy who swaggers on into town. And within a few months, he's leading a bus boycott that's wildly successful. He launches Free DC. I mean, he really establishes himself as a community activist and someone who at his core, I mean, yes, he loves the attention. You know, he loves the attention that brings, especially from women. He likes the power of being able to do things. But he wants to do things for people. He wants the people to love him. And then, you know, this is true in when he's in SNCC in the early 60s. It's true when he's at Pride in the late 90s. The late 60s. It's true when he's running for mayor. You know, he wants people to love him. He wants the power mm-hmm. to do things for the city. And he really does. I mean, he does, especially his first term. I mean, he does a remarkable job of opening up this very closed bureaucracy, of empowering people who've been shut out of these rooms. And to us, we see this, we see this excitement and the thrill of seeing a civil rights veteran at the helm of a major U.S. city, not just any city, but the capital of the United States. And mm-hmm. it's really exciting. It's really this part of the fulfillment of the hope of Chocolate City. But we also have to talk about what happens next, right? And see what happens mm-hmm. as he himself falls victim to drug abuse. And you know, he's not able to do the job that he wants to do and that he was doing. And so that by the late 1980s, you know, the city is spiraling out of control with the crack epidemic, and you know, the numbers of young black men who are killed in the city reaches epidemic proportions,
mm-hmm.
In the high 400s, and he's not able to stop that. Yeah. And
he's not able to do things like reform the bureaucracy. Mm-hmm. I mean, he comes into office, and the bureaucracy's got 44,000 around folks. And at the same time that that's happening, there's not a growth industry in the city, right? The number of service workers that the federal government would normally be hiring is actually shrinking. And so the way that he figures out how to deal with making sure that people in the city who aren't doing white collar work, which is actually expanding at this time, expands, because he's not just interested in taking care of the black middle class, he's looking to figure out how the black working class can get jobs. He decides that the best way to do that, and these are very hard choices he has to make, is to increase the bureaucracy. That may have worked out if he was a better manager. He just didn't care as much about the nuts and bolts of managing the bureaucracy as he did in paving a way for minority enterprise or getting people jobs. After that, he didn't really want to make sure that parking meter folks were nice to people, or when you called the city, folks spoke in a specific way. That wasn't really something that he was desirous of doing. And by the way, folks resisted him. Ivanhoe Donaldson, who's one of his buddies from SNCC, and who was really sort of a hatchet man. I mean, people were scared of Ivanhoe Donaldson, right, in the bureaucracy. He said, these folks are so hard to deal with. I mean, I can't make things happen. You know, it's something that would take one day ends up taking 10 because folks just resist you. And so not only does Barry not really want to do this part of the job, but this part of the job is even harder than it should be, right? And in the end, he's not able to sort of get the bureaucracy in the shape that he needs it to be. And so, by the late 1980s, we have a bureaucracy that's one of the largest per capita in the nation, and really does a horrible job in many of the services that affect poor DC residents. We actually do a great job of collecting money from tickets, right? Like the DMV is always relatively good, right? But things like elder care, services for social services, those really aren't where they need to be. And a huge number of poor DC residents are really adversely affected by that.
And so you see, for us, we see Marion Barry as really this tragic hero, this man with great gifts who did a tremendous amount, particularly early on in his career. And built a coalition. His winning coalition was an interracial coalition. Mm-hmm. He had gay voters from Logan Circle. He had the Post's endorsement unexpectedly. He had poor black folks. He had all kinds of people who were behind him in 78. Mm-hmm. And over time, his coalition splinters, and largely along race and class lines, to the point where very, very few white people support him by the late 1980s. And you saw this with when he died a few years ago, where there was this outpouring of grief and sorrow within the black community, particularly in low-income black communities that had become his base. Whereas in white communities, there was a kind of a shrug or a complete lack of awareness about why this man would be celebrated, which is really unfortunate because he was heroic in so many ways, and it was a tragedy to see the arc of his career go down, because he did so much for the city, and he put DC on the map in so many ways, and to see what happened in the late 80s, both to him personally and to the city, was really tragic.
And if I could just add this, one of the things that we really consistently come back to, one of the themes in the book, is that this is never just a local story. I mean, this is the nation's capital. Congress has ultimate oversight authority over the city. It can intervene in our internal affairs. And, when you talk specifically about Barry's story, you cannot exclude Congress and the president. Going into 1988, 1989, the Bush administration, in order to clean up its racial image after the Willie Horton ad in the 1988 election, recruits a police chief to change parties, his lifelong Democrat, and to run against Barry going into 1990. And so none of this is happening, sort of in a vacuum. I mean, there's local politics, but those local politics always have these national players circling and trying to use the city for their own reasons, right? And so that's also very much part of the story that we tell. And part of the story of Barry that I think gets lost. Because you have to remember that in the same time that the mayor is recruiting the police chief to run against Barry, he's also using D.C. as an example of a total breakdown of law and order. So much so, as he says in his first primetime television address in 1989, that you can buy crack in the park across the street from the White House and hold it up, right? It comes out later, of course, that the DEA had set up the young man that they bought that crack from, and a local
had to
jury
drive him in and then plop him in Lafayette Park and then buy from him.
And a local jury became so angry that they had used the city and this young man as a prop in a speech that they did not convict him.
And taking a step back from Barry a bit, I mean, these are themes that run throughout, right? This idea that we are the capital, and that comes with a special burden, special responsibility, mm-hmm. And that you know, on the one hand, DC is a stage, right? It's a stage where people come from mm-hmm. around the country, from around the world, to see American democracy in action. Whether it's you know, at the dedication of the Lincoln Memorial, where white people from North and South come together in this reconciliation at the expense of Black folks, or the March on Washington, you know, where the Civil Rights Movement stakes a claim to Lincoln as the great emancipator and Lincoln as the racial egalitarian, mm-hmm. to say, no, this is what American democracy should look like. So it's a stage, but DC is also a battleground, right? Mm-hmm. You know, members of Congress, national leaders, they fight over what happens in DC because they're fighting over what they want to happen around the nation, right? And DC is a template. We see this with urban renewal, right? And what happens in urban renewal, where it's like a laboratory, right? Where they test out these policies, and they can do it here because they have the power to do it here, right? Mm. DC residents ultimately can't stop it, or they think they can't stop it.
And you know, and one of the fascinating aspects of the story is that power is largely amoral. Right. Mm-hmm. If you look at the radical Republicans of the Reconstruction period, they move into D.C., bring compensated mm-hmm. emancipation, voting for African-American men.
Black public schools.
And then, of course, the city council during Reconstruction brings non-discrimination laws. Right. You don't allow Black folks to come and eat in your restaurant. You can be fined by the city during the late 1860s, early 1870s. Right. And so here you have radical Republicans from elsewhere experimenting, using DC as a laboratory. And it is, I think we would judge from our vantage today, good. Fast forward 120 or so years, and you have another group of radical Republicans experimenting with the city during the control board era. Mm-hmm. And they're doing things like foisting charter schools on the city against pretty much the voice of every elected official in the city, except for Anthony Williams, right? Who largely goes along with it, not because his constituents ask him to, but because he knows Congress is going to do it anyway. Mm-hmm. And Newt Gingrich just flat out says, Speaker of the House at the time, we're going to use D.C. as sort of an urban testing ground for all of these conservative ways that we think we can address policy. And he believed that the control board moment was a moment where he could go in there and just try out everything, right? And D.C. could do nothing about it.
This has been fascinating. I look forward to you coming back, and I'm sure that you'll have many contentious book signings and discussions about this with some native Washingtonians. Thank you very much for being on UDC Forum.
It's always great to see you.
Thank you.
If you would like to know more about my guests and their book, Chocolate City, A History of Race and Democracy in the Nation's Capital, visit the website of the University of North Carolina Press at uncpress.org. If you're interested in learning more about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. And to learn more about the many degree, certificate, and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.